gather on this Sunday before the celebration of our nation's birthday on Tuesday. So our worship this morning will have somewhat of a patriotic flair to it. Hopefully, when you came in, you picked up your little patriotic, I don't know, it's a fan or what it is. You use it for a fan, I don't know what it really, that's what it is supposed to be or what, but I hope you picked one up as your memento for worship today. This being the celebration of the Lord's Supper, everything is in your bulletin except for the hymns and the order of confession. So at this time, I'd ask that you turn to page 94 in the front of your worship book and invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, clothe the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
We now begin to worship with God Bless Our Native Land, hymn number 891 in the back of your worship. In number 891 in the back of your worship.
Thank you. Let us pray. O God, you direct our lives by your grace, and your word of justice and mercy reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God's word.
Connie Singleton will be doing the reading.
So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you now are ashamed. The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life, for the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pastor John Pollock has ascended the pulpit higher than any other area to show our great respect for the gospel, and Jesus is here with us. Pastor John Pollock.
Given her a dignity that shouts, freedom is everybody's.
of the United. That means that we have all come together. Individual communities that have united into 48 great states. 48 individual communities with pride and dignity and purpose, all divided by imaginary boundaries, yet united to a common cause, and that's love of country, of America. And to the Republic, a republic, a sovereign state in which power is invested into the representatives chosen by the people to govern. And the government is the people. And it's from the people to the leaders, not from the leaders to the people, for which it stands, one nation, meaning so blessed by God, indivisible,
Lisa Horinko.
Thank you, Lisa. You may now take out your sermon notes for sermon today. You will notice that in your bulletin right under the sermon title is printed the text, Proverbs 14:34, so it will make it easy for you to follow along as I proclaim God's word. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In 19th century England, there was a brilliant historian by the name of Lord Macaulay. And Lord Macaulay one day was asked his opinion about America. And he made this prophecy. He said, quote, "Your republic will be pillaged and destroyed just as ancient Greece and Rome. But the one to destroy your nation will be the citizens of your own country, the products of your own civilization." End of quote. And that's a prophecy that should cause chills to run up and down our spine, that this honored historian, this brilliant historian, is prophesying that what will doom America is not a foreign army, but ourselves. We as citizens forgetting what America is all about. Now, prophecy is totally out of whack and there is no possibility of it becoming a reality. But as we look across the landscape of America today, as we prepare to celebrate, if I calculated it right, her 241st birthday, we have to wonder if the beginnings of Lord McCollum's words are becoming true. For as we look across America today, we see some politicians, some, not all, but we see some politicians, whether they're Republican or Democrat, conservative, liberal, or socialist, doesn't matter their leaning, but we see some politicians and their followers seeming to have the attitude that if they don't win, then they will do everything they can to obstruct the ones who won, no matter how good of legislation they propose for our nation. Their job is to obstruct, to make sure people don't become reelected instead of what is best for America. For those of you old enough, go back with me to 1964. President Lyndon Johnson is proposing the Civil Rights Act. Now, President Kennedy had actually submitted it to Congress in October of 1963, but of course we know President Kennedy was assassinated, and from November through January, our nation was in mourning and basically at a standstill. But when the new year began, Johnson wanted to get this legislation pushed through Congress and signed. The Democratic Party at that time had 67 senators, Republicans 33. The Democrats had the majority in the House, and so it should have passed easily. But there was one problem. President Johnson could only get 47 Democrats to support the Civil Rights Act because 22 Democratic senators, all from the states of the Confederacy, from back in the days of the war between the states, were opposed to it and started to filibuster. Now the Republicans could have taken the attitude of some politicians today and said, well, we're not going to do anything. We're not going to let anything pass because we don't want this president reelected. We didn't win. We didn't want to regain control. But instead, they thought about what was best for America. And they knew that the Civil Rights Act had to be passed and passed now. And so 47 Democrats, 33 Republicans, voted for the Civil Rights Bill, and it passed, and Lyndon Johnson signed. And as we think about our nation, we see that that's the way it's always been. That presidents and Congress have always worked together, even if they were from opposing parties. After Johnson, we had President Nixon. President Nixon oftentimes had a Democratic majority, and he was able to work with them to get through important legislation. The same thing with Carter, the same thing with Reagan, the same thing with first President Bush, the same thing with President Clinton. And then suddenly in the past 16 years or so, Washington developed this attitude of what's best for us, not what is best for our nation. So how do we regain this cooperation? How do we convince those we elect to serve us to go back to cooperating, no matter what party is in power, to do that which is best for our nation? So that the economy can boom, so roads can be, and bridges can be repaired, so education can improve, so technology can be advanced, so that our military is strong. To answer that question, we turn to the wisdom of Solomon. We turn to King Solomon's Book of Proverbs, to that 14th chapter, that 34th verse. And in that one verse, King Solomon, who remember ruled Israel at its greatest height, its greatest power, its greatest influence. In this one verse, he gives us the wisdom we need in order to go back to cooperation and what is best for all people. Righteousness exalts a nation, and sin is a reproach to any people. Pretty simple. Or it seems. But we've made it difficult. When speaking about making a nation better, politicians usually talk about a mighty military, a strong economy, the development of resources, improvement in education and technology, as they should. However, Solomon is telling us the greatest gift a nation has, its greatest treasure, is righteousness. Righteousness is a nation's greatest treasure. So what do we mean by righteousness, or what does Solomon mean? The Hebrew word we translate as righteousness means faithfulness to God. It means to live a life of virtue. It means to be faithful and virtuous in all our actions with the help of the Holy Spirit. And when we do so, then we can be powerful and successful. Faithfulness to God and trying to live a good Christian life brings peace and harmony to society. Ignore God. Ignore his law, ignore his teachings, ignore virtue, and you have anarchy and confusion and little progress being made. You have people demonstrating in the streets just for the purpose of demonstrating and being disruptive. Some months ago, I was watching the evening news, and there was a demonstration one of our major cities, and a reporter was asking some of these young people what they were demonstrating about, and not two of them could come up with the same reason why they were demonstrating. Some of them said they were just doing it because their friends were doing it. Others said it because he said, look, it got them out of class. When you have no morals, when you have no ethics, when you have no laws, you have anger. You have confusion. You have disruption. So a nation chooses its path to be righteous, to be faithful to God and to his law, to believe that God sent his only Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Or a nation can choose to just go with the flow, to let anything happen, to do your own thing, to fight the power to the people, give peace a chance, all you need is love, or any other slogan someone happens to create with no foundation to bring it about, to make it a reality. I grew up when college campuses were full of idealistic people saying, give peace a chance, and all we need is love. And I knew a few college students who left the university to go off to some commune out in California somewhere, or up in New England, or some other place, thinking they were going to find paradise on earth. And as we've read time and time again, when you have no morals and no ethics and no values based on a supreme being, you end up simply living like animals with might makes right, the stronger survive, the strong prey on the weak. And soon we heard stories from these communes about how a person or persons would rise to the top and they would dictate who loved and who didn't. They dictated what you did or didn't do, and it turned out to be a little dictatorship. Because their idea of all you need is love was not the love. of God and our neighbor as ourselves. That love of Jesus Christ, which tells us as his followers we are to love one another and to serve God with all our heart, and all our mind, and all our strength. No, it was physical love. It was all it was based on. Carnal love. The desire of the flesh, which is here today and gone tomorrow. And so the communes fell apart. And a lot of idealistic young people realized they needed to go back to college and get a real degree and make a contribution to society. Solomon tells us, after he tells us that righteousness exalts a nation, he tells us that sin is a reproach to a nation or to any people. Righteousness exalts. That word exalt means to extol, to raise up, to lift up. America throughout our history has been raised up, extolled, and lifted up as a shining example of how a nation can rule in democracy or representative republic, and how people can overcome their circumstances, born in poverty, born to a family that has no special name. How you can rise from your situation of lack of education or whatever. Anyone can be elected mayor or city councilman or county councilman. Anyone can be elected governor. Anybody can be elected to the state legislature. Anyone can become a congressman or a senator or even president of the United States. So we've been uplifted and raised up to other nations. So as that shining city on a hill saying, see what can be done when power comes from the people up to the government, not from the government down to the people. But now we see that becoming distorted. We see government trying to become more powerful. And it's all because we have forgotten that righteousness. Instead, we seem more interested in sin. Sin means an offense against God. It means a habitual action against God. It means to be a habitual offender. All of us sin. And what Solomon is talking about is he's not talking about those who believe in God and our Lord Jesus Christ. That yes, we do sin every day. He's talking about people who willfully throw off God and his morals and values and ethics and think they can do whatever they want and live however they want. And who cares about the effect it has on someone else? I have this right to be me and do what I want, and I can care less about what you think. And so, habitual sin. People habitually violating the norms and laws of society bring about the inside death of a society. If you go to your history book, most of them will tell you that the Western Roman Empire ended in 450 AD when the final barbarians conquered Rome, defeated her legions, and destroyed the Roman system of government throughout Western Europe. But you read other historians, and they will tell you that actually Rome was dead before 458, because her society had died years before. Her society had changed from being a moral society, a lawful society. It had changed from being that society in which Constantine the Great had declared Christianity would be the faith of the empire, and Christian morals and values ruled and influenced the justice of a Roman system. Suddenly there was a desire to go back to paganism and to go to a life of simple pleasure. And these historians like Gibbons will give us the real reason Rome fell. And those reasons were heavy taxes, demand by the people for more leisure time, for more entertainment put on by the government, attack on the traditional family, attack on the traditional values, an attack on the Christian church and its morals and ethics, and a demand for the government to pay for everything. That is what brought the Western Roman Empire to its knees. Its freedom destroyed it. And that is what Lord Macaulay is saying. We are in danger of misusing our freedom so that we bring about our own collapse. The word reproach means a disgrace, a wicked thing, or destruction. So Solomon is telling us sin, habitual sinning, habitual offending God, being an habitual offender to God, destroys a nation, that it becomes a wicked thing, that it becomes a disgrace to itself and to the rest of the world. Solomon is warning us that no matter what the modernist or the humanist or the secularist or whatever they want to be called say today and try to rewrite history, the reality is our nation was founded on the Judeo-Christian heritage. And Solomon is warning us that if we ignore that heritage by allowing sin to run rampant without any consequences, then we will become a disgrace to the rest of the world. We will become a wicked thing that is heading for destruction, either totally from within or from within and without, attacked by a nation that snuck up and became stronger in us because we were too busy reveling in the desires of the flesh. Neither nations nor individuals can sin and win. Neither nations nor individuals can sin and win. Because there is an Almighty God who is perfect, who is holy, who cannot stand sin, no matter how small. But out of his love for us, has sent his Son Jesus Christ, so that through repentance we do win through his death upon the cross. A biblical commentator, Dr. Charles Bridges, commenting on the book of Proverbs, and specifically noting the 34th verse of chapter 14, says, quote, "What an enemy ungodly man is to his country," end of quote. Think about that. What an enemy an ungodly man is to his country, or her country. More of an enemy than an enemy spy trying to infiltrate our cities. More of an enemy than a foreign army trying to attack us. More of an enemy than the terrorist who blows up a building or starts shooting in a mall. But the ungodly person in a nation is its worst enemy. The godly person strengthens a nation. The ungodly person helps bring the destruction of society and helps speed up its decline through immoral, unethical, and bad living. On the other hand, a nation is blessed by righteous citizens. Citizens righteous, not because of who they are or what they do, righteous because of their belief in God. Righteous because of their belief in the Lord Jesus Christ. Righteous in their intent to live how God desires us to live. These righteous citizens are those who go to work every day, who pay their taxes, who do the best job they can at work with the abilities they've been given, who support their neighborhoods, who practice their faith,
bring blessing upon a nation. A nation is disgraced by the ungodly citizen, by those who cheat and steal, by those who conduct fraudulent business practices on customers. Never understood a person how they can claim to be a Christian and then purposely defraud customers. But I've known a few in my day. Or the one who overcharges and then underperforms. Or another so-called Christian I knew who would take used parts, recondition them, and then sell them even brand new from the factory. Then you have those who turn a 5-minute break into a 30-minute shopping spree. Those who refuse to pay their employees a fair or recommended wage. And those who waste their money on alcohol and drugs until becoming an addict and then meeting the resources of those who work so hard to break the habit that they should have never started. Such behavior destroys a nation from the inside out. There's one lady that comes around our church. She uses the rainbow table, she uses the pantry, she uses the thrift store. She told me how one night she had to be Narcan twice. That is, she had an overdose of heroin twice in the same night, and they had to use Narcan to bring her back. Every time I see her, I ask her, why? What do you need to be convinced to get off that stuff and to change your life? She just continues to live off us and to take her heroin and destroys a nation. Righteousness is not legislated, but lived out by individuals. That's your answer to question 11. It should be but instead of by. Righteousness is not legislated, but lived out by individuals. How we live makes a difference for the future of our country. That is why we have to be careful with how we handle our freedom. Have to handle freedom responsibly. Just because we can do something doesn't mean it's right. Just because we can get away with something doesn't mean it's right. So we have to be careful how we handle this freedom that we have been blessed with. We are free to help our country and make it great. But we're free to hurt our country and make it weak. Let us prevent the prophecy of Lord Macaulay from becoming a reality. Let us take to heart the words of the wisdom of King Solomon, that righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. And let us incorporate those words into our daily lives. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Those who can, please rise. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate.
He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Our response is, hear our prayer. Father, we thank you. You have released us from the law, and we belong to Christ. Help us always serve you in a new life of spirit, and bear fruit for you, Lord. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we thank you for all you do to provide with daily bread. Be with us who work to grow fruits on the earth, and you have given us food. Give them favorable weather and a successful harvest. Bless also all involved in the commerce and industry of our land. Allow the fruits of their labor to provide the materials needed to many who rely on them. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we thank you for our nation and for the many freedoms that you have provided for us here. Guide our elected and appointed leaders to serve us with integrity. Be with those who defend our nations in the armed forces, as well as our police and firefighters, who protect our freedoms closer to home. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we thank you for the freedom from sin, sickness, and death that will come with full manifestation of your Son's kingdom. Give comfort, healing, patience, and endurance to all who suffer from illness, industry, or chronic afflictions. Strengthen their faith so that they know that despite their suffering, they are not lost their reward. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we thank you for the seasons of the means of the travel of the earth that you have given us. Keep safe all your journey, whether by land, sea, or air, and bring them safely to their destinations and see them home again. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we thank you for your great cloud of witnesses that surround us. Join our praise and theirs, and bring all at last with them into the full freedom of your kingdom. All this we pray through Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Time for our offering. Karen and John Dietrich are the ushers for today. This is Sunday, July the 2nd, 2017, the fourth Sunday after Pentecost. 4th of July is coming right up. It'll be this Tuesday. And this is in honor of our country. We had our lesson today that we are righteous if we love God, love our neighbor, and righteous citizens are what has made our country great and will continue to make our country great. We have an announcement. St. John's Lutheran Preschool Daycare. We're accepting enrollment for the 2017-2018 school year. Our school program is designed to provide quality loving care and instruction for children ages 2.5 through 5 years. The staff will give opportunities for mental, physical, and social, emotional, and spiritual growth. Hours of operation, 6:30 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Friday. Preschool program will run every day from 7:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. Afternoon hours are less academic, more constructive play. Full-time fee is $150 a week. Part-time is $75 a week. We accept Title 20 and discounts will be offered for families who send multiple children. So this is important for giving a chance for the gospel for children. This may be their only chance. We are reminded the outreach store is closed July the 3rd. We have sign-up sheets for the drive-in church to volunteer for St. John's booth. We're going to have a booth at the Clark County Fair July the 21st through 28th. So, 2-hour time slots, be sure to check out our booth. We see Karen and John Dietrich bringing up the offering. We're happy to have you with us. It's July the 2nd, 2017, fourth Sunday after Pentecost. We're looking forward to celebrating the 4th of July this week.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we are, but as we are. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we, and all who share in the body and blood of Christ, may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated.
This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, are receiving Holy Communion in the true body and true blood of Jesus Christ, as he has instructed us to do, and he has promised us eternal life. We are taking this both for ourselves and for others, bring peace to the world, to continue with our nation, to continue with our planet, to love God, to love our neighbors, to preserve the gospel that's given to us as we are righteous through our belief in God, through our love of our neighbors, loving God and love our neighbors. We're practicing righteousness, and we will preserve God's witness to us. We will be righteous as a nation and as an individual and as a church.
By our Lord Jesus Christ, with precious blood, strengthen, preserve you in true faith until life eternal. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with Faith of Our Fathers, hymn number 812, in the back of your worship book. Hymn number 812, Faith of Our Fathers.
Our closing hymn, Faith of Our Fathers, was written in 1849 by Frederick A. Faber. Frederick Faber was an Anglican priest who converted to Roman Catholicism. He is honoring the martyrs of both Protestant and Catholics. Faith of our fathers. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. We're celebrating the birthday of our country and the faith of those who came before us, martyrs, Protestant, Catholic, all different martyrs who love God, love their neighbors, and who have suffered because of this. Faith of our fathers, 1849. We invite you to come to St. John's anytime, 8 o'clock, drive-in service, Melody Cruise in, 10:30, worship service. Watching us on YouTube, we invite you to watch us anytime, Our 10:30 service is always on YouTube anytime you want to tune in. And if you know how to do it, obviously you do, you're watching it, show other people how to tune in on YouTube. St. John's Lutheran, we're at the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We invite you to worship with us as Jesus has commanded us to do. This is a way that we can be in communion with God and have a face-to-face encounter with God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We can have a face-to-face encounter by those we serve and by our worship and also by studying the Word. We thank you, Lord, for our country. We hope that our country and our earth will be preserved from now and forever. We hope that we will continue as you have commanded us to love you and love our neighbors. This is the July 2nd, 2017. Our 8 o'clock service is still at the Melody Cruisin' Drive-In. We'll be through Labor Day, started Memorial Day and finished Labor Day. But our 10:30 service is always here at the sanctuary. 10:30 service, corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We invite you to come worship with us anytime. We're happy to have you help us with our daycare. We're happy to have you help us with our outreach store and with our rainbow table, as we are doing as Jesus said, as you have done it to the least of these, my brethren, our brothers and sisters, you have done it unto me. And we are doing this through encountering Jesus Christ through our neighbors every day, every minute of every day. Just as God has said, love God, love your neighbor. He's set a plan out for us, and all we have to do is follow us. It's not difficult to repent, believe, love God, love your neighbor. But this is what will save us, save our country, and save the whole world through peace. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.